Hello students. So students, we are on chapter 11, that is enhancement of food production. And as discussed previously in the previous session of this chapter, we had started with animal husbandry. And in this particular session, we will be doing all the animal husbandry that is practiced in India. Okay. So the first one is dairy farm management. And students, dairy industry, it involves production and processing of milk and distribution of milk and milk products. Now, milk, as we know, that it is a valuable foodstuff and it is universally consumed by almost every human being. Now, milk yield, it mainly depends on the quality of the breed that is used in the farm. Selection of good breeds having high yielding potential under the climatic condition that they are inhibiting in, and disease-free or disease-resistant breed are the basic requirements to maintain the dairy farm. Now, when we speak about particularly India, in India, when we speak about cows and buffaloes, there are Indian as well as exotic breeds of cows that are seen, that are used for obtaining the milk and milk products. Now, these are some of the Indian and the exotic cows and buffalo breeds. Indian cow breeds are three. There are three main Indian cow breeds: Sahiwal, there is Sindhi, and there is Gir. And when we speak about exotic cow breeds, that means the cow breeds which are introduced to India from different parts of the world. There are again three: Jersey, there is Brown Swiss, and there is Holstein. Okay, so these are the cow breeds. Indian buffalo breeds. In India itself, there are six buffalo breeds. So it is Jafrabadi, it is Mehsana, it is Murra, it is Nagpuri, Neeli, and Surti. So these are the six buffalo breeds which are good milk producers. Okay. Now, dairy farm management, it involves management of dairy animals like cows and buffaloes. Other than this, there are sheep and goats as well. And the animals are taken care against various diseases. They are inspected on regular basis by the veterinary doctors. So, you know, just obtaining the products from them is not what is dairy farm management. With that, you have to maintain the health of these animals also. So, a healthy animal is physically, mentally, and socially sound. So you have to maintain these animals not only physically, mentally, and socially as well. Now, if we speak about milking of these animals, they are milked by two ways, either by hand or machines. So if there is a person who's into this dairy farm management on a smaller scale, he will use the manual process of milking these animals by hand. But there are some people who do this dairy farm management on a very large scale, okay, where they take care of n number of these animals. So there they use several machines for milking the animals to obtain the milk from these animals. Once the milk is obtained, it is preserved and it is converted into dairy products industrially. And then it is used for commercial purposes. Okay, so this is about the dairy farm management in India. Now, there are certain cleanliness and hygienic conditions that you have to maintain for handling these cattle, and it is very important. Okay, it has to be very important and it has to be taken in consideration. There has to be proper storage and transport of milk and milk products. Then, other than this, there are also, the cleanliness of the shed. Okay, it has to be maintained. It has to be the shed where these animals are inhibiting in. It has to be spacious enough, okay, with adequate facilities for feeding them, watering them, and proper lighting condition. Okay, now students, I'll repeat it again. In this chapter, there are, you will be, you know, learning different names of species of these animals and plants, okay? And that is what you have to learn in this chapter mainly. You have to remember all the species of plants, all the species of animals, because that is what is asked in the exam in regards with this chapter. Okay, so I have already told you all in the previous session, I'm again telling you all that in this chapter you mainly have to focus on different breeds of animals, different scientific names of plants and different disease resistant plants that are grown in India, all of it. Okay, so this is what you have to mainly do in this chapter, because it is a very vast chapter where you have to learn many names. Okay, so you have to learn these things. Now this was about the dairy farm management. Next is poultry farm management. And poultry farm management, it includes mainly number of bird species like chicken, duck, turkey and fowl. So in poultry farm management, it is domesticating these birds for eggs and meat. Now there are some allied professions with the poultry farm management, which includes processing of the eggs and meat, then marketing of the poultry products, then there is compounding and sale of the poultry feeds, then with this marketing and distributing the poultry equipments, then there is pharmaceutical and feed additives. So these are all the allied professions with the poultry. Now selection of proper and disease-free breeds of these birds, then suitable and safe farm conditions, proper feed and water, proper hygiene and health care are very important requirements for the poultry farm management. Okay, now for this you have to maintain the sanitation and hygienic condition. Okay, so as we know that these animals, they give us eggs and meat, which are very rich source of protein and which are in high demand universally. Okay, and to obtain a good quality of yield from these birds, it is very important to maintain a disease-free environment in which these birds are residing or in which these birds are inhibited. Okay, now there are two other beneficiary things that are obtained from poultry farm management. First, the fecal matter from the birds. So these fecal matter from the birds are used as manures to improve the soil fertility. Okay, and the second thing is that poultry farm management, it provides employment to a large number of people that actually helps in improving the economy of the farmer. Okay, so these are the two other benefits which comes in hand with the poultry farm management. Now selection of proper and disease-free breeds, as I told you, it requires suitable and safe farm condition, it requires proper feed and water. Hygiene and health has to be maintained. Okay, and on the basis of their origin, there are different types of poultry breeds which are seen universally. When we speak about American breeds, there are Plymouth Rock, then there is New Hampshire, then there is Rhode Island Red. So these are the three American breeds. There are again three Asiatic breeds, Brahma, Cochin and Langshan. So these are the three Asiatic breeds. If we speak about Mediterranean breeds, there is Leghorn and Minorca. English breed is Australorp, and Indian breeds are Chittagong, Brahma, Asil and Kadaknath. Now out of all these breeds that we have studied over here, Leghorn is best for layering, that is to obtain eggs. So Leghorn is mainly used in the poultry farm management to obtain eggs. Whereas Plymouth or Plymouth Rock or Rhode Island, Brahma, Asil and Kadaknath, they are used for boilers. That means they are used for meat obtaining purpose. Okay, so Leghorn for egg, Plymouth Rock, Rhode Island Red, Brahma, Asil and Kadaknath for meat. Now, when we speak about management of layer, that is, what do you mean by management of layers? That means when you are rearing these birds for mainly obtaining eggs from them. So that is management of layers. Management of layers, it requires conditions like high yielding chicken. Then there has to be well ventilated farms. Proper feeds have to be given to these chicken. Debeaking. Lightning has to be maintained and managed properly. Then waterer, there has to be good waterers, and other than this, there has to be proper sanitation and vaccination. And when we speak about management of boilers, that means when you are rearing these birds mainly for meat production, it requires selection of proper good breed, okay, which gives good meat. Then housing, proper housing, the temperature has to be maintained as required by the breeds. Then ventilation, of course, it has to be well ventilated, the farms has to be well ventilated. The floor has to be, you know, spacious. Okay, so floor space is very important, and there has to be proper boiler feeds for these birds. Now with this, there are different types of poultry disease also which are observed. Now these diseases are viral, bacterial, fungal, parasitic and protozoan diseases. Viral diseases like rinitis, bronchitis, avian influenza, that is bird flu. These are the three viral diseases. Now few years back, we have observed that bird flu, it had a very serious impact universally. Okay, and it has influenced poultry farming and human infections too. There were many humans which were infected by consuming the birds which were suffering from these this particular viral disease, that is avian influenza. Bacterial diseases are pleurone, cholera, typhoid, TB, and then there is chronic respiratory disease. Then there is enteritis. So these are the bacterial diseases. Fungal disease are aspergillosis, then favus and thrush. So these are the three fungal diseases caused by fungus. Parasitic diseases are lice infection, roundworm, sickle worm infection, etc. And protozoan disease is coccidiosis. So these are different diseases that are observed in birds. So to avoid any kind of infections, it is very important to maintain the hygiene and disease-free environment for these birds. Okay, next let us move to apiculture or beekeeping. So apiculture, it comes from the Latin word, that is apis, which means bird. Okay, so apiculture, it is taking care and management of the honey bees, or artificially rearing these bees to obtain bee products like honey and wax mainly. Other than this, pollens, bee venom, propolis, that is bee glue, royal jelly, and these bees are also used for pollinating agent for crop plants. So beekeeping, it is an ancient cottage industry. Honey is a food of high nutritive value and also finds uses in indigenous system of medicines. Now there are certain importance of beekeeping. First, it provides honey, which has a various, you know, it has n number of medicinal values, and it is the most nutritive, valuable nutritional food that is said. Then it also provides bee wax, which is used in many industries, including cosmetic industry. There is bee wax, which is nowadays in cosmetic industry, bee wax is in high demand. Then it is used in polishing industry, it is used in pharmaceutical industries. Then it plays an excellent role in pollination. So it is, as I said, that it is used as a pollinating agent for crop plants. So these bees, they play an excellent role in pollination. Then honeybees are the best pollinating agent, and it helps in increasing the yield of several crop plants. Now also, according to recent studies, the honeybee venom containing a mixture of proteins which can potentially be used as a prophylactic to destroy HIV that causes AIDS in human. Okay, so it also has its the beekeeping or honey from these bees, it is also used for curing HIV or destroying the HIV virus. Okay, now the common varieties of bees that are seen in mainly in India, we'll speak about the species that are seen in India. The four species of honeybees commonly found in India is Apis dorsata, which is also commonly called as the rock bee, and it is a giant bee which produces about 38 to 40 kgs of honey per colony. So this is Apis dorsata. Okay, then there is Apis florea. So Apis florea, it is referred to as little bee. This is Apis florea, and it rarely stings. Okay, it does not sting, it rarely stings, and thus honey extraction from its hive is easy. So if there is a hive which is of this Apis florea breed, okay, so you can easily extract the honey from their hives because they do not sting or they rarely sting. It produces about 1 kg of honey per colony per year. And the last one, that is Apis indica, which is commonly referred to as Indian bee, okay, and it can be easily domesticated. It is most commonly used for honey production, and the annual yield of this bee is about 2 to 5 kg per colony. Okay, so this is Apis dorsata, that is rock bee. This is Apis indica, which is Indian bee, and Apis florea, which is little bee. Now let us also speak about the polymorphism of honeybee. So beekeeping, it is practiced in the area where there is sufficient wild shrubs, where there are fruit orchids, where there is cultivated crops. Okay, and beekeeping, it requires equipments like beehive box. If you are artificially doing it, you need a beehive box. With comb foundation sheet, you need a bee wire, smoker, bee brush, gloves, gum shoes, uncapping knife, swarm net, queen excluder, and overall hive tools. So this is the artificial bee hive. Okay, so all of it is included. There is bee queen excluder over here. There is a wax foundation which is there. Then there is this floor bed and the entrance inducer. Then there is hive bodies. These are the two large hive bodies. So artificial beehive, one must be very familiar with the habit of bees. If you are into this, or if you are planning for artificial beehive for rearing these bees, you have to be very familiar with the habit of bees, and you have to select a suitable location which is the most optimum for rearing these honeybees. Proper management of the hives during different seasons, okay, it has to be maintained. Collection of honey, bee wax, and other products. Then period inspection is required, okay. Then Indian crop field needs the service of honeybees as pollinators. So as I told you, it is used for pollinating the crop plants. So crops such as sunflower, mustard, safflower, chili, cabbage, cucumber, legumes and fruits like apple, mango, citrus, etc. helps increasing the productivity of honey and crops tremendously. So it is give and take kind of a relationship. The honeybees, they help in pollinating these plants, and these plants in turn, they help in increasing the productivity of honey. Okay, so this was about apiculture. Next, let us move to the next animal husbandry, that is fishery or fish farming. So fishery is a branch of applied biology which deals with the catching, processing, fish farming and marketing of fish and other useful aquatic animals such as prawns, lobsters. Then there is oysters, mussels and crabs. Now the three divisions of fisheries are inland fishery, then there is marine fishery, and then there is estuarine fishery. Okay, so fish farming or pisciculture, mainly they are of two types: extensive aquaculture and intensive aquaculture. When we speak about extensive aquaculture, it is based on local photosynthetic production, and intensive is based on external food supply that is given to fishes. So when we speak about extensive aquaculture, which is based on local photosynthetic products, that means these fishes which are into this fish farming by extensive aquaculture, they feed on the local plants or the plants which are grown in that particular farm or that aquaculture. And intensive aquaculture means these are based on external food supply. That means these fishes are fed externally by external food supply, So this is extensive and intensive. And the three divisions that we just spoke about is inland fishery, that there is marine fishery and estuarine fishery. Let us study about these three. Inland fishery is freshwater bodies like ponds, rivers. So the fishes which are obtained from these freshwater bodies like ponds, rivers, lakes, dams, these are inland fisheries. And India covers 40 to 50 lakh acre of land for inland fishery. And these are the three main, the fishes which are obtained from the freshwater. Labia rohita, that is rohu fish, which is very common and it is very famous. Then there is katla, okay, and then there is mrigala. So these are the three inland fishes. Then there is marine fishes, that is the sea water fish. And India covers, as we know, India covers a coastal line of about 7,500 kilometers long, okay. And the common marine fishes are Bombay duck, okay. Then there is sardine, then mackerel, and pomfret. So these are some of the marine fishes. And estuarine fishes are the fishes that are obtained from the estuaries. And the example for this is in the Sundarban area in West Bengal. Okay, there is a large estuary, the Sundarban itself. So the fishes that are obtained from this Sundarban area comes under estuarine fishery. Okay, next let us move to sericulture. So sericulture, it is an applied branch of zoology which deals with rearing of silkworm, okay, and production of silk. Now, like other farming, sericulture also involves silk skills and scientific knowledge for rearing and development. It requires less investment and can be started in small space. Now, this is one of the oldest business and large number of families are associated with this production of silk in India. Okay, so the best quality of silk is the mulberry silk by the silkworm that is Bombyx mori, and tussar silk or tussar silk, which is also called as tussar silk, and the airy silk are the low quality silk. Okay, the quality and the quantity of silk, it depends on the quality of the mulberry leaves on which the larva feeds. Okay, so if we speak about the life cycle or the metamorphosis of the silk moth, which actually is involved in the production of silk or the sericulture, there is this adult moth which lays egg on the mulberry leaf. This is the mulberry tree over here. And then these eggs, when they hatch, they form the larva, they feed on the mulberry leaf, and then they form this cocoon and form the pupa. They go to this pupa stage, and from this pupa again an adult moth is released. Okay, so when it forms this cocoon, so silk production, it is mainly the threads or the silk which is produced when this particular larva forms the cocoon. Okay, so if you see in this picture, these are the silk threads. So this particular larva is getting into the pupa stage where it is forming this cocoon around it. Okay, so the threads which are obtained from this cocoon are used in silk industry for the production of silk. Okay, now rearing and development and looking after the silkworm, it again involves skill and labor. If there is a little negligence, this can spoil the entire industry. Okay, so silkworm larva, it can be infected by protozoans, viruses and fungi. Besides this, ant, crow, birds and other predators are also always ready to attack these insects. So rearing and development of this particular business, it involves a lot of skill and it involves a lot of labor work. Okay, so this is about sericulture. Next, the last part of animal husbandry, that is lac culture. So lac is produced by an insect that is Trachardia laca, and it is a small sized insect and it is colonial in habit. Now raisin like substance is produced by the dermal glands of the female lac insect. Now these insects, they feed on the succulent twigs of certain plants like bear, peepal tree, then there is palash, Kusum and Babul, and they secrete a pink colored resin. Now this resin, it hardens on coming in contact with air and then it forms lac. Now it is produced on a large scale all over India. Lac, it is a complex substance having a large amount of resin together with sugar, water, mineral and alkaline substances. Now natural lac, it is always contaminated. And shellac is a pure form of lac which is obtained by washing and filtering. So after it is produced, it goes under proper processing where shellac is formed, and that is the pure form of lac. Now lac insects, they are native to India, and our share in this lac industry is about 85% of the total lac produced in the world. Now the products that are the lac plays a vital role in is in the economy of the farmer. So the products that are used are or that are made from this lac are bangles. So you must be very familiar with these types of bangles. So these bangles are made up of lac. If you see in this picture over here, this is the lac which is produced by the insects. Okay, that is Trachardia laca. These are the insects that produce this kind of lac. Other than this, it is used for making toys. Then there are several woodworks. There is ink. So this is lac ink. And a mirror. In mirror work also it is used. So this is about lac culture. So students, we end this session over here. And in the next session, we'll be moving to the last part of this chapter, where we'll be speaking about microbes in human welfare.